Welcome back. I'm Molly Van Howling. I'm Professor of Law and Associate Dean at the Law School, where I teach intellectual property, among other things, and think about open access in my work time and my spare time as a board member of Creative Commons and also of Authors Alliance, a relatively new nonprofit that represents and advocates for authors in their interest in being accessible and being read. So I'll have some questions for our panelists about the interests and confusion that authors sometimes suffer in the open access world. Our topic for the panel is Open Access, Many Perspectives, Changing Goals, Shared Vision. And it features luminaries from UC and nationally who have led the way in terms of in terms of advocacy and also implementation of open access policies and innovations in open access publishing. I will introduce all of them briefly. You have their full biographies in your program, and then we'll get started with presentations from each of them, some conversation, I think, among our panelists, and then we'll open it up for Q&A from the audience. First, we'll hear from Chris Kelty, who's professor of information studies and anthropology at UCLA, and especially relevant to our discussion today, was the chair of UCOLASC when it adopted the UC open access policy. So I think he'll be telling us some war stories from that era. Catherine Mitchell is director of Access and Publishing at CDL, and among other things there, she is the operations director for UC's Office of Scholarly Communications, where she has much responsibility for the rollout of the open access policy, for giving guidance to scholars who need to comply with it. So we'll be hearing from her about some of that implementation on the ground. Next, we'll be hearing from Nick Shockey, who is Director of Programs and Engagement for SPARC, the Scholarly Publishing and Academic Resources Coalition. He's also a founding director of the Right to Research Coalition, an international alliance of student organizations that promote open access to the results of research through advocacy and education. And Nick, I think, will be telling us some things that are happening on the national advocacy scene, but also giving us some views from the perspective of researchers, both students and more established researchers. And then finally, we'll be hearing from Allison Muddett, who has been the director of UC Press since 2011. She'll be talking to us about some of the innovative programs there in open access publishing, including Calabra and Luminos, which I hear has recently published the first 6 books in its open access monograph series. So I'm sure we're all anxious to hear about how those particular programs are going and how she's thinking about innovation in publishing more generally, and maybe about the future of publishing in light of our keynote opening address. Okay, Chris, why don't you take it away?
Is it all right if I sit here?
Sure.
Can I sit here? You can hear me from this? I'd prefer to sit if I can. I'm really bummed to have missed Michael's talk. The capricious god of California, which is to say Southwest Airlines, intervened to prevent me from being here. But I may have a few things to say that are that amplify, respond to, etc. My charge here is to introduce some of the history of the OA policy here at UC, and I'll do that. But I want to frame this by asking a set of larger questions, because having worked on this topic for 15 years now, both as an advocate and to some extent as a scholar and anthropologist of open and free culture, I find myself wondering often if open access is a goal or a means, right? And it slips back and forth between being a goal and being a means, depending on who you talk to. And I sometimes ask myself, do we remember what problem open access was a solution to, right, as we move on? What do we expect to happen if we achieve partial or perfect open access, for instance? Once upon a time, open access was a great idea for taking advantage of an even greater technological threshold, the arrival of the internet, but it has become other things too. It's now a critique of a one-size-fits-all intellectual property system. It's a condemnation of a particular style of extractive publishing. It's a mythology of freedom and creativity. It's a stab at equalizing things amongst those who want to learn and think. So it can be many things, and as a result, tends to blur. So I hope part of what we can discuss today is the question of whether open access is really the solution to something and what that problem was, or more importantly, if we really know what that problem is and how we can diagnose it better in the future. So let me say a little bit about the history of the open access policy at the University of California. Most people will know the basic background, so various statements of principle and policy in 2001, 2003, Budapest, Berlin, Bethesda, other places that begin with B. Berkeley Creative Commons licenses in 2003, the launch of PLOS Biology in 2003, federal but relatively weak OA mandate in US in 2008, Wellcome Trust, RCUK, and EU policies push for gold OA around 2011. In May 2012, UCSF passed an OA policy by principally at the hands of Rich Schneider, followed by a UC-wide policy that was passed here in June of 2013. And little birds are telling me that the final piece of this puzzle will happen perhaps on Monday, which is an expansion of that policy to cover all non-tenure-track faculty at UC, a presidential open access policy. Depending on your discipline, other highlights in this history might be important to you. Different people claim different origins. Physicists and computer scientists will point to Archive. Biologists might point to GenBank or Entree. I was reading Postmodern Culture and Bryn Mawr Classical Review as an undergraduate at Santa Cruz in the 90s. Librarians will probably rightly claim they were all doing all of this before it was cool. your mileage may vary. At the University of California, interest in making difference started in 2005. And one has to credit some of the administrators who are no longer serving with a lot of the sort of stoking of this fire, in particular Dan Greenstein and Mary McDonald in the Office of General Counsel. And the idea was pursued jointly by the Academic Senate and the always delightfully acronymically named SLASIAC, the System-Wide Library and Scholarly Information Committee. Ben Crow of UCSC oversaw the first effort to get an OA policy passed as head of the UCOLASC at the time. And that process saw the creation of arguably the first real open access policy designed for a research university, and it was diagnostic of certain assumptions about open access at the time. Most importantly, the committee at that time agonized over the nature of the proper process for getting an exception. They proposed three different options, but all assumed that in order to be accepted from the policy, a faculty member would have to proactively seek permission, probably offer a justification, and then be formally approved. The devil details of bureaucracy aside, what was important about this assumption was that open access was seen as something the university could use its power to mandate and make real in the public interest by forcing faculty to comply, unless they had a good reason not to do so. The arguments against doing this, they thought, would come only from publishers defending their revenue streams. What was perhaps not clear at the time, however, was that this approach pits the value of open access against the value of academic freedom. And so pitted against each other, I can say, as a result of my experience, faculty members will choose academic freedom over the public interest in a clear, unambiguous majority every time. This may be a despicable fact, but it is a fact. And so the first attempt was a failure. But given this fact, other people, notably Stuart Schieber and Peter Suber at Harvard, could make sense of the problem after watching the case unfold here. And they cleverly asked, how can you have open access cake and eat academic freedom too? The answer, an opt-out clause. So Harvard's open access policy presented to faculty a very simple mechanism which preserved the individual right of faculty to choose whether or not to participate. No permission was needed, no infringement of rights was necessary. All a person had to do was say, oh, thanks. If they said nothing, they would be covered. If they said no thanks, they would not. It wasn't even really clear that they had to say it to anyone. This opened a loophole that a lot of people worried publishers would abuse absolutely, forcing faculty to opt out in order to get anything published. Perhaps luckily, the number of publishers engaging in such behavior has remained low, hovering around 5%. So despite the frustration of many of the more principled founders of open access, opt out was here to stay. And it opened the floodgates, so hundreds of policies were passed in the following couple of years, all of them with this opt-out clause. Meanwhile, back at UC, the most recent financial crisis was in full swing in 2009-10, when the Nature Publishing Group issued a 300% increase in its subscription fees to the California Digital Library. The crisis that resulted included a threatened boycott of all Nature, although I understand I'm not supposed to use titles anymore. publications opened a brief window in which it seemed for a moment possible to imagine a different world. So CDL, together with faculty members led by Rich Schneider and Keith Yamamoto at UCSF, issued a challenge to NPG. They said, we don't want to pay for subscriptions anymore. UC accounts for a significant percentage of Nature publications each year, as much as 12% in some cases, which was enough to bring them to the table. But in the end, it was not enough to make them do anything truly revolutionary. The conversations dwindled. The grand plans to create an alternative funding model based on submission fees, article processing fees, and open access in the bargain dissipated into a series of phone calls and non-committal announcements. And in the end, no price increase. So NPG had extorted us, we had called their bluff, but nothing had changed. So what this moment revealed, to me at least, was the increasingly dangerous distinction between green and gold open access. Dangerous because rather than introducing an equality of open access, it introduced and amplified a long-standing set of suspicions across the disciplines. It was at this point that we really started to hear people in the humanities and social sciences, and I would credit this campus with that in particular, start to suggest that OA is only a STEM problem, only a science, technology, engineering, and medicine problem, and should be resisted by right-thinking humanists and social scientists. Similarly, medical scientists covered by the NIH mandate seemed to think the problem was solved, and that humanists and social scientists should exit their primitive cultures and join the rest of civilization by figuring out a way to pay to publish. Now, the threat of paying to publish has a kind of immediate and terrifying meaning to most people in the humanities, instantly generative of conspiracy theories and Chicken Little stories. Humanists and social scientists shared with certain sectors of the medical sciences the mistaken assumption that all scientists and engineers had the money to pay for publishing, for open access, when there are clearly massive inequalities within the sciences. Think nursing versus cancer research, or genetics versus botany, or nanotechnology versus civil engineering. Demands for Gold OA ramified these inequalities at the very moment that solidarity across the disciplines had become necessary. And it introduced an inequality into the process of producing open access, one based on increasingly scarce research funding, the relative power of administrators to channel money to different departments, and a whole host of discipline-specific publishing practices. Add to this the adoption, at this point, of hybrid OA by the publishing industry around 2010, and the attractive email offers that started to show up in people's inboxes, offering to for the low, low price of $3,000, publish an article. Now, forget for a moment that this, despite protestations, this is almost inevitably a way of publisher double dipping, charging scholars for OA and libraries for subscriptions at the same time. $3,000 is, for the bulk of people in the university, everyone except the cancer researchers, I would say, a lot of money. It's kind of an insane price, actually. It's twice the cost of a good laptop. It's rent for a month or two for most people. It's good money for a quarter for a research assistant. So my experience suggests that nothing has turned the tide against solving the OA problem from an economic standpoint as much as the idiotic and constant promotion of hybrid OA by the publishers. So by contrast, green OA is on the side of equality. All it does is attempt to take back some of the rights that publishers had become accustomed to claiming without forcing anyone to do anything costly or inequitable. Green open access is about rights, about repositories, and about the university doing the right thing by its employees. So in 2011 and 12, when interest in a system-wide open access policy was renewed, the first and most difficult hurdle became distinguishing green and gold and insisting that green was a necessary step and that gold was a can of worms that no single institution, funder, publisher, or even government really had the power to solve in every case. Making that distinction clear, despite the helpful use of not quite primary colors, was not easy and still is not easy. I would like to refer to gold OA as red OA now, but we can't change the colors. The process of bringing the OA policy to the Senate was an education, then, in both the power and the bloody-mindedness of our faculty governance system. If I did anything for those 2 years, it was simply to educate people, going from campus to campus, committee to committee, explaining what open access is, how a policy might work, the difference between green and gold, the economics of publishing, the differences between, yeah, you get it, different disciplines. But the one thing that really got people enthusiastic about the policy was talking about the state of the scholarly publishing industry. Its absurd profit margins, its relentlessly raising subscription costs, the bundling problem, etc. Rich Schneider created a really fantastic deck of slides showing in detail all the ways in which we were being screwed by the publishing industry and why we had to do something about it in quick-like. The virtue of this approach is that it makes people mad and it makes them want to do something about it. But it doesn't really make green OA seem like the solution, right? Let's deposit our articles is not really a slogan revolutionary might utter on the way to the barricades. So, but it was clearly a successful strategy because Rich was able to convince enough of his colleagues at UCSF to pass an OA policy in May of 2012. Now, passing this policy at UCSF was both a wrench in the works, given the, how shall we put it, ambiguous federalism of the UC system, and an essential starting point and guiding light for the rest of the process. Passing a policy at UCSF was its own self-contained challenge. The school is small, it has almost no one in the humanities or social sciences, it already operated under the NIH mandate, etc. But passing a system-wide policy opened up a very different set of concerns. And I just want to talk through about four of them briefly so that you get a sense of what we have had to think about in order to do this. And some of this is internal to UC politics and the bureaucracy, but it might be illuminating for you to understand what happened. So the first of those was the question, where would such a policy live? The faculty at UC have, by comparison to other universities, a very strong governance system, of which we should be proud and protected. But in terms of actual power, we really have control of one measly document, and that's the Academic Personnel Manual, the APM. We can't make changes to any other university policy without cooperation from the president's office. We can't change the intellectual property policy. We can't change the policies of the California Digital Library. We can't change the policies set by the chancellors at our home universities. So it seemed at the outset that the only thing we would be able to do would be to change the APM. Now, for those of you who've not seen the process of changing the APM, let me assure you that on average, it consists of between 1 and 3 years of intense debate and review about whether, for instance, to change the word may to the word should. The prospect of inserting a whole new policy into the document seemed rather unlikely. So in the end, after what felt like countless discussions with Martha Winokur, who was the executive director of the Senate, it was eventually decided that it should not go into the APM, but should be a freestanding policy adopted by the Senate. The problem with this was that no one really knew what kind of doctrinal status or force this policy would have, where it should live, what force it would have, or who would keep track of it, even. This is sort of most evident in the fact that the existing policy requires a deposit of an article into a repository, but there's no express or implied sanction or enforcement of that of any kind. At best, CDL, and they don't do this, but they could, harangue faculty members with endless deletable emails saying, please deposit your articles. Beyond that, we have no power to enforce it as the academic center. Two, would it be central or distributed? Much discussion was also expended on whether to pass the policy centrally or to write it centrally and ask the campuses to adopt it separately, or to simply wait for the other campuses to follow UCSF's lead and pass it on their own. Here is a secret you may not know. CDL was absolutely adamant that it had to be centralized, because the thought of trying to implement 10 different policies made their heads explode. And here's another secret, which is that at this point there were like 4 people in the entire UC system who were committed enough to try and get an OA policy passed at this point. Me, Rich Schneider, and I forget who the other 2 people were. So the idea of just leaving it to the campuses was kind of a non-starter. In the end, it became clear that it had to be something that would go out for system-wide review, be revised, reviewed again, and ultimately adopted by the Academic Council, possibly going to a vote by the legislature. All of this, not the state legislature, but our academic legislature. It all seemed very daunting. 3, who would implement the policy? Although it was discussed and debated, it was really never a question who would implement the policy, California Digital Library. This would never have been a conceivable thing to do without CDL. And I don't have much more to say about this other than what I say every time I talk about this, but I'll say it again, which is that every faculty member at UC should thank CDL for their impeccable and hard work, send them chocolates at Valentine's Day, upload their stinking articles to eScholarship, and not talk shit about CDL unless they have a really, really good reason. Four, there was the question of how we would get feedback from anyone, from everyone in the system. Because, of course, this affects everyone, so you can't possibly impose it unless everyone is consulted, right? The process of system-wide review of Senate policies is necessarily an imperfect one. For those of you in the audience who are faculty members, I don't need to point out to you exactly how much you ignore of what the Senate does. I ignore something the Senate does every day, at least twice a day, actually. And so getting everyone to know about a policy, much less approve or disapprove or comment on it, is not just impossible, it's actually designed not to be possible. And this is because, and I'm looking here at my faculty colleagues who remember little of their high school civics classes, because our system is a representative democracy. The system engages committee members to represent different constituencies, even if haphazardly and inevitably unequally. So if I never hear another complaint from a faculty member about how they were not consulted about some policy or another, then I will die in peace. That said, my experience of the system-wide review, which went through 2 complete rounds lasting 18 months, was on the whole a positive one. I saw a tremendous change in awareness about this issue from the beginning to the end, from something like maybe 1% of the people knowing what was going on about open access to maybe, generously, something like 15%. That's not huge, but it's a significant change. So I'm not tooting my own horn, but even if the policy hadn't passed, I feel like it would have been a major achievement and worth the 2 years I spent trying to get people focused on this issue. So let me end by just proposing some lessons for the future. A green OA policy is a great thing to have, and I'm glad we have it here. But on its own, it's a very small step. It's a major achievement to change the default, which is how we describe the OA policies. 15,000 UC faculty members can now say implicitly and without lifting a finger to a publisher, I am keeping my rights, rather than having to say, can I have my rights back? Right? So, and apparently on Monday, if this policy goes through, it expands to about 40,000 faculty members, scholarly, academic appointees. But a green OA policy fails to do two things, which will not have escaped your notice. One, actually make something open access. And two, solve the economic problem facing scholars and scholarly publishing. Fortunately, I think for the UC system, the first of these, making open access happen, is something that CDL is committed to doing, and so far showing great success at doing. And so I will defer to Catherine to explain how we can and should tackle this going forward, and how we can take advantage of such policies to make it easier. Also, fortunately for the UC system, the second of these issues, solving the economic problem of open access, is something that the UC Press is trying to pioneer, along with a handful of others in the publishing world. And so I'll defer to Allison to explain how, and to Nick to explain how the policy angle on this is actually making a difference as well. So let me end then by pointing out all too briefly, but hopefully clearly, some things that I think open access as symptom should reveal about what ails us more generally. And this is to return to my opening point that I think there are broader issues at stake here. The first, obviously, is money. The debate in OA is now about money, about business models, about gold OA, about the sustainability of scholarly publishing in a world where access is a primary virtue. And I don't mean the publishing industry, I mean the act of publishing. Who's going to pay for it? How? Is it going to be a collective? Is it going to be an industry that's separate from the university? Is it going to be pulled into the university? The debate is now about these kinds of models, forms of collaboration, collectives are forming. I'm part of a collective in the anthropology world that's trying to do something like this. Access may not be, so access has been identified as a virtue, and it may not be the only virtue, but it has been established as a central one in a way that it never really was prior to the advent of the internet and the open access movement. Now the problem is how to pay for it without killing ourselves. Two, complexity. The details of scholarly publishing, open access, intellectual property, internet technology, on down the line, are way too complex for everyone to understand and will never be something that everyone grasps. So how can we make it simpler? The fact that all these things are intimately connected to how we do our research, how we evaluate it, how we communicate it, validate it or invalidate it, all these things mean that we need to rethink how we talk about this problem in order to make the problem simpler and clearer to people, that it's not just about open access. Three, inequality. I don't think we can any longer operate with terms like faculty, scholars, and authors without making some distinctions about which kinds of faculty, scholars, and authors we're talking about. This has become painfully clear to me in the process of passing the presidential version of the open access policy, where we're moving from 14,000 faculty who are ladder faculty in the Senate to close to 50,000 people who are academic appointees, right, who don't have any faculty governance system, cannot govern themselves, et cetera, are basically in various states of precarious positions, not permanent positions. We need to address this fact, and some work indeed in the university is valued more than others. Some publications, some kinds of publications are respected more than others. Some people are more likely to benefit from OA than others. If we want to understand the presumed general public benefits of OA, we need to think about our own publics here at home. And fourth, and this is my last point, too many publications. Last, but certainly not least, I leave us with this simple thought. We publish way too much. I was going to use an expletive there, but I'll spare you. The biggest reason that we have the problems we have with scholarly publishing is that we have a system that rewards more publishing at any cost. That is unsustainable and irrational. But what would it take to publish less? And what would be the effects of doing that? Right? It might seem contradictory for a proponent of open access to urge publishing less, but I increasingly think it serves the same public interest goal, not just access, but access to the highest possible quality work. So I'll stop there. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. I think this is a kind of a bland title. I think I should have called it Upload Your Stinking Articles. I'm going to use that next time.
You can have that.
I'm the pragmatist today. I'm going to talk about what it means when you actually try to implement one of these policies. What it means when you try to implement one of these policies across a 10-system campus and collaborate with your colleagues and the libraries on those campuses and their unique cultures and the faculty voices that emerge in that setting. Mostly I'm going to talk about the data, because we just finished a report. We are 9 months now into this publication management system that is meant to automate things and engage people less so that they will do more. And so I want to share some of that data with you, beginning with this, which I really think is a thrilling visualization of basically since the policies, and I say policies because we have the UCSF policy and the system-wide academic senate policy, since the policies were adopted, we have been collecting publications both manually submitted and now through the publication management system. This map represents all the places where those publications have now been accessed in the world. And though you see a lot of red in North America and Europe, you also see wonderful red dots out in what looks like water. And up where things are usually white on maps. So this is pretty exciting, because I feel like, you know, all questions of the value of OA or green OA aside, these papers are getting to people, and they're getting to people all over the world. And those people may not be researchers, and they may be people who have an interest in this research for other reasons. So the other important thing to know is that we have no sticks. As Chris mentioned, there is no penalty to faculty if they don't comply. We don't even use the word comply. We say participate, because compliance implies that there will be repercussions if you don't, and there aren't. I want to talk exclusively about the deposit requirement, which is a unique challenge in that setting. The grant of license and waiver support, other parts of the policy, but I'm not focusing on those so much today. The question is, how do we find ways to keep faculty engaged in their policy and to realize the promise of that policy by depositing their research? In theory, a policy is wonderful. In practice, we need to show something for it in order to be able to count the ways or measure the ways in which it's made a difference. So we used to try to engage faculty with this form, which we felt initially was wonderful. It has fashion colors. It has contextual advice. I mean, that was pretty cutting edge. But the problem with this form was that it required that faculty first remember the, well, let's back up, know about the policy, and then upon publication, remember the policy, and then go find the form, and then once they had found the form, feel motivated to fill out all of the fields, the metadata fields that perhaps they didn't remember the title of their paper, perhaps they weren't interested in doing this. So we did this, and what happened was mostly nothing. mostly nothing except for one case, which I will mention in a moment, but mostly nothing, because that's a lot of hurdles. And so we decided that what we needed to do was find a way to automate this process to some degree, to make it less onerous, to make the initiating moment not with the faculty, but to prompt the faculty to involve themselves in their policy. So we moved to something that we're referring to as the publication management system. This system is basically a tool. It's actually Symplectic Elements, which is a current research information system, that can harvest the records, metadata, for publications associated with UC faculty or any group we assign it, then sends out an email alert to the faculty to alert them to the fact that one of their publications or many of their publications have been found. Those email alerts are being crafted by the campus librarians, which is wonderful because they can be unique to the campus, they can be unique to the culture and the best ways to communicate. Once they get the email alert, if they open it, and we're tracking that, then they can click through into the system where they verify their publications. They don't have to enter any metadata. The publication records are already there, and upload a file. So just to give you a sense of so this is a pie chart that shows all of the different sources of information that we're using, the data sources for the records. And it's a lot of the usual suspects. We have Crossref, we have Scopus, Web of Science, REPIC, all sorts of sources. It's definitely skewed towards STEM, which is an issue that we've been working with the vendor to fix. But in any case, we collect all of these records, bring them into the system. Here's an example of an email alert. This is currently my favorite. This is UCSB, and they've done a wonderful job of sending something that doesn't require that you read a lot of text. There's a yellow button. You just click it. It even tells you how many publications you have waiting for you, which is nice. And once the faculty click through that yellow button, they find themselves in an interface like this, where, and it may be hard to see, but you'll see that there are two buttons. There's a green and a red. The green means claim it. I claim it. It's mine. The red means no, this doesn't belong to me. And once they do that, if they claim it, they're taken to an upload page where all they have to do is find their version of their publication, the author's final version, and upload it into the system. It gets automatically deposited in eScholarship, and they're done. So we're 50% of the way to implementing this on all of the campuses. Shout out to Merced, they went live yesterday. So ahead of us, we have Santa Cruz, San Diego, Berkeley, Riverside, and Davis. This should all be done by January. And that in itself is an enormous achievement. The campuses have worked hard to make this happen. It's involved, you know, shibboleizing the system so that faculty can log in with their campus credentials. We need data feeds from HR. A lot of folks are collaborating to make this happen in ways that we haven't before, and it's really been exciting to see. And it's working. So orange is what's been deposited since the publication management system began. And I feel kind of torn about this. I'm very pleased that UCI made so much progress. There's one person in the audience right now who will remain nameless, Mitchell Brown, who has ruined my graph because he did so much work with the faculty and got so many folks manually depositing, which is incredible. But he can attest to how much work that was. A lot of work.
Just label that the Mitchell Brown.
Mitchell Brown. That is, we call that the Mitchell Brown effect. We really do. And so the orange, basically, you can see that, okay, so green, maybe you don't see, but green is before the policy's passed. Blue is what happened once the policy's passed and we only had manual submission. Orange is where we are now, which is automated harvesting, contacting, faculty interacting with the publication management system. We've also noticed that some disciplines are more involved than others. On the far end, you see medical and health sciences, physical sciences, and mathematics. In some ways, no surprise, because those are fields where this is already a culture. But also, maybe those are fields where people publish more, too. We need to do more analysis to understand, is this a proportional representation, or is this the effect of open access cultures? And you can see also the orange represents folks who are depositing articles. They also have the option to provide a link if their publication is already openly available elsewhere. Green represents the link. So mostly it's articles. There's some link activity around medicine and health sciences, which again is no surprise. The faculty who are depositing are having positive feelings about this experience. 56% rated the experience as somewhat or much easier than expected. 32% indicated that the deposit experience was about what they expected. Now, they may be cynical, or maybe this is a good thing, but in either case, you know, it's the majority are not surprised or pleasantly surprised. And they have really warm, fuzzy intentions. 92% of the respondents, oops, sorry. 92% of the respondents indicated that they were either very or somewhat likely to use the system to deposit another publication in the future. That's really good data. But that's what they feel like they're likely to do. Actually making them do that, because the only, you know, the hurdles are more than just is the system onerous. It's also, do I have time? Can you get my attention? All of that. Here's an interesting graph. This is, again, very early stage of implementation, but so of the known OA policy eligible publications for three campuses, UCSF, Irvine, and UCLA, the pilot campuses in this project, of those OA eligible publications, 33% of them have been claimed by the faculty, which means they went into the system and they said, yes, that's mine, no, that's not mine. But the blue represents the yes. And then of those claimed, 18% have been deposited via this publication management system. So we have them in the system, they're interacting with the system, they're claiming, and they are depositing, but clearly not at the rate that they're claiming. So this is really important for us to know. We've gotten them there, what can we do to get them engaged at that point to actually find the file? Or is that the barrier? Is that the barrier that we have to find new solutions for? I like to share the complaints you might hear so that everybody hears them up front and no one's surprised. Okay, this system, like many, punishes the most productive people by making them do yet more busy work. I publish a lot, so this is really a pain for me. To which you can say, well, you know, proxies can do this for you. Publish less. Absolutely. Publish less, and if you can't help but be so prolific, find a proxy. We can actually set people up, usually graduate students, to do this work for you. Another complaint, why don't you partner with sites like ResearchGate or academia.edu, where we are already uploading our publications? Why do we have to do this in multiple places? This is a really legitimate complaint, concern. We have a problem with those kinds of sites because they're not open and they're not exchanging data with us. So faculty need to understand that whatever they're doing there, they're doing in a closed system, and we can't help them with that. But we don't want to be yet another silo. Why don't you automatically download published articles from journals? I would love to do that. And I think that would be wonderful. In fact, we could imagine a sort of node in the sky where all the journals send their articles, and then we just go get them, and everybody's happy. So if we take the faculty out of this process, we eliminate a lot of points of failure. The challenge is to get the publishers to participate, and I actually think this is a very interesting direction. Also, connect this with other online systems that do similar work. We need to do that too, and it's something that we're very, very interested in. We're already collecting a lot of this data on the campuses for tenure and promotion review. There are systems like Opus at UCLA and MyData at Irvine and Profiles at UCSF, where a lot of this work is already being done. So the future of this really is in integration. It's in finding ways to make this process part of something bigger where faculty are already engaged, instead of asking them to pay attention to something that they're already paying attention to elsewhere. My slides seem to have disappeared at this point, so but I only have 2 minutes. I just want to end by saying we feel really optimistic about this. We feel like this is a step in the right direction. We have data. We can show what the effects are of the system, of the collaboration, of the work between the CDL and the campuses. And it seems like an important moment to start to think about, you know, what is the relationship between what we're doing here and what's happening at a national level? And how does this system and this publication management system tool fit into the kinds of requirements for compliance that the faculty are getting from agency funders, from private funders? How can we work to move what the library is doing into the broader realm of sponsored research, academic personnel, all of those spaces. And we have a real opportunity to do that now that we have this system in place. Thank you.
Nick Shockey is next. I know Nick can speak from the perspective of students and other researchers, maybe.
Mike left, I was gonna pick on him.
Who might aspire to be points of light as opposed to points of failure, is that what you call them?
I should have said potential.
So after Chris's wonderful presentation, I found myself wondering whether Mike's lovely green shirt was a political statement, but then I noticed his shoelaces were gold, so I think he was just fully representing sort of the entire spectrum of open access. So I'm tasked in 15 minutes, actually I'm gonna need to time myself too, so I can try to accomplish this, to give you a quick update on sort of what's happening in the policy sphere nationally around open access. But also talk to you about my favorite thing, which is engaging sort of the next generation in leading the open access movement. I think they sort of asked me to sort of talk about what open access means to early career researchers and students. But I actually generally like to flip it on the that sort of thinking on its head, because I think, you know, generally there are appreciable differences about what open access means to early career folks. But I think it's actually more important to talk about what early career researchers and students mean for the open access movement. So I'm going to tell you, since I only have a few minutes, three short stories about four extraordinary individuals and how they're sort of reflective of larger engagement of early career researchers in the open access movement. So to dive right into the open access policy update first, we are in the thick of sort of implementation of the 2013 White House directive on public access to publicly funded research. How many people have heard of the directive? Yeah, that's what I thought. So most people, some of you that may not be familiar with it, this was a policy that came out 2 years ago now, essentially directing 24 federal agencies to develop plans to require that articles that they fund be made freely accessible online within roughly 12 months of publication. That's sort of the sort of very broad overview. They were due a while ago. Still at this point, we actually only have 16 of the 24 agencies have released their plans. And these aren't actually sort of the policies themselves, they're plans to establish the policies. So 2 years later, you know, we still haven't seen this come to implementation. So, you know, it's probably the biggest single win that we'll see in the US. It's huge in setting a strong precedent, but we're still a long way from actually seeing the effect on the ground. Hopefully at the turn of the year, we'll see all of these plans out there and, you know, start moving towards implementation. But there's a lot of variety in the way that these plans are going to be implemented. Right now, there are nine of the agencies that are going to go with PubMed Central as the point of their deposit, which we've certainly really liked to say. We really like the centralized PMC model and what that allows researchers and students to do with the work, as well as sort of the preservation, all the things that come with being located in PMC. Some of the agencies have chosen to go with a publisher-run sort of alternative called Chorus that points essentially to publishers' websites where they will make copies of the articles accessible. And then a few of the agencies have actually opted to handle this completely internally. So that's sort of a taste of what's going on. There are sort of lots of different flavors of these policies. And so sort of coming out of that, one of the things that's really started to bubble up over the last few months is that there really is an important role for universities and libraries to play with complying with these policies. Institutions are actually the ones that are the recipients of these grants, so it's institutions that are sort of on the hook to comply with these policies. And so a number of libraries are starting to think about sort of what that means for them and how they can support the campus and sort of the larger university in complying with these policies. And also it's been really interesting to see university leadership and big organizations like the AAU and APLU start to take note of this. And actually yesterday we hosted a webcast on this exact topic and had Mike Tanner, the chief academic officer of APLU, present on sort of how they would like to see universities help with compliance and sort of the importance of libraries in helping with this. So building on that, we at Spark would really like to codify this directive. While the directive is absolutely a big win, it's also not very durable. So if you remember way back, we'll harken back to the high school civics class again. these directives can actually be overturned with the stroke of a pen. The next administration could come in, decide they don't want to do this, and overturn it immediately. It's not very durable. There are also sort of improvements to the policy that we would like to see. So what the Fair Access to Science and Technology Research Act, or FASTER, would do is codify that policy into law so it is much more durable. Depending on which chamber of Congress you're in, it would shorten the embargo period from 12 months, which is where most of the agencies are, down to 6 months in the House. So it's been amended in the Senate to 12 months, but I'll talk about that in a second. So it would improve on the embargo period. It would also put stronger language in around making sure that articles are available in formats and under licenses that allow for reuse. Important to know that it is completely bipartisan in both the House and the Senate. It was introduced in the same day in both places. So many of you that have been sort of in the open access space for a while probably remember us introducing FASTER in the last Congress, us introducing FERPA, its predecessor, when we were much, much worse at naming bills. And the three Congresses prior to that. So, you know, there's a long history of open access being an issue in the U.S. Congress, but this summer we reached a landmark when the bill was actually passed out of the Homeland Security and Government Affairs Committee in the Senate, which is a huge, huge step forward. You know, most legislation never makes it out of committee. It's actually extraordinarily difficult to do. It sounds, fairly easy, like, hey, you just have to get out of committee. It's a nightmare. So it's a huge step to have it out of the committee. It actually gives us a lot more options about how we might actually be able to get the text of the bill passed. And I think sort of its passage out of committee sort of leads into my last point on the policy update, which is I think we're really seeing a mainstreaming of open access as a policy priority. One of our lead champions of FASTER is John Cornyn, senator from Texas. And you know, he's been a huge advocate. He's been on the bill since we started introducing it, but he's now the Senate Majority Whip, which means he has a lot more power to push this forward. And so we've actually gotten to the point where a lot of what's happening with FASTER is almost out of our hands. It's actually, what's happening is really politics. You know, it's horse trading with, you know, Senator Cornyn and our other supporters and others that don't have as favorable view of the legislation. And that's a whole different area for us to be in. You know, for the last, you know, 6-8 years, we've been having conversations about sort of why this is a good idea and trying to convince people. And it's really interesting to see it sort of take the next level where it's actually in the hands of our political leaders to try to get it enacted. So I think we're really moving in to a whole other space. And we've also had a lot of meetings with a lot of our sort of wider leadership in Washington, D.C., and with some of the folks that are looking for the nominations coming up next year. And you know, we've had really, really positive meetings with you know, leadership across the board, both for open access as well as for open educational resources. And so it's just really incredible to see sort of the support that's starting to sort of align for both open access as well as OER. So I will leave it at that, but I'm happy to talk more about the policy front in the Q&A, since now I only have 7.5 minutes left for my favorite stuff. Could I get my water? So to try to actually keep myself to 15 minutes, I'm going to tell these three stories that I think are very illustrative of sort of wider student early career researcher engagement in the open access movement. So I will start with a product of the UC system. This is Meredith Niles, who was a PhD candidate at UC Davis, I believe just as recently as a little over a year and a half ago. And I think Mike's texting her picture of the slide right now. I'm sure her ears are burning in Vermont. She's now an assistant professor at the University of Vermont. But while she was here, she was involved in student government and the grad student government at UC Davis, as well as at the University of California Student Association. She was actually really active as the UC policy was, you know, trying to be passed to put the student support and signal strong student support for the policy. They also really pushed the system to include graduate students in the policy, which hopefully will very soon be a real thing. But she led that effort to try to get grad students included in the policy as folks that, you know, that do a huge amount of the research here in the UC system. So she was sort of very at the forefront of advocacy at the institutional level. At the national level, she served as the legislative concerns chair for the National Association of Graduate Professional Students, which is sort of like the national grad student organization. And in that capacity, she led a couple of different sort of advocacy days where think probably over 50 graduate student leaders from around the country came to DC to meet with congressional leaders about open access, which has been one of their sort of central topics for a number of years now, as well as some other issues. And they've been successful in actually getting co-sponsors added to FASTER and FERPA before that. So she's, I think, a great example of how students are really, or students like Meredith are really leading their peers and establishing open access really as a key priority and something that early career researchers really care about. And now that she's sort of moved on from those organizations, she actually serves with Mike on the board of PLOS, which I think is great to see PLOS sort of showing how important early career researchers are by putting one on their board. So that's sort of Meredith's story. And she's definitely extraordinary, but there are lots of other students and early career researchers doing things just like her. We have the UC policy now. There are actually a number of other campuses just within the last few months that have established policies because of early career researcher and student advocacy, like the University of Colorado at Boulder, which recently put an institutional open access policy into place that students had a large sort of share of the credit in pushing that forward. Also, I think very interestingly, at the University of Hawaii, Manoa, the graduate students there actually put a policy in place on themselves. That's an institutional open access policy that applies to graduate students. So essentially expanded their policy to cover themselves, similar to what hopefully will happen soon with the UC system, which is great. And there are other policies like that at Rutgers and Stanford as well, where students put these policies into place. 5 minutes, all right. Ooh, talk faster. So that's Meredith. It's fantastic. So that's sort of an example of a peer leader of early career researchers pushing for open access. Now I want to talk a little bit about sort of some students that are actually establishing entire organizations, national organizations, to promote open access. So this is Rashan Karn, who is a medical student in Nepal. And about 18 months ago, he established an organization called Open Access Nepal, which advocates for, as you might imagine, open access, both at the institutional level within Nepal as well as at the national level. And we met Rashan at a conference of medical students. He became really interested in this topic, went back, and then got in touch a few months later saying, hey, I just started this organization called Open Access Nepal. And we're like, this is fantastic. So they've already established chapters, I think, at nearly all of the major universities in Nepal, doing presentations to raise awareness about open access, meeting with university administrators to try to promote institutional open access policies like UC's, as well as meeting with actual national policymakers as well, trying to get policies put in place at the national level, which is just incredible that they were able to establish this in less than 18 months. They did a lot of this stuff in less than 6 months, which is just, it's phenomenal. And even though there was the 7.8 magnitude earthquake in Nepal this April, despite sort of that huge challenge, they've continued to plow ahead sort of fearlessly, and actually during Open Access Week next week, I think they'll be doing presentations on many, if not most, of the major universities in Nepal, which is incredible. And we're actually seeing outside validation of groups like Rashan's, with UNESCO actually approaching Open Access Nepal as a potential convener of a regional meeting around open access, which I think it's incredible to see that sort of external validation for student groups like this. And sort of very excitingly, Rashan, like I said, very extraordinary, but there are lots of other people doing very similar things. So there are national student organizations that have been established, like this one in Tanzania, in Sudan, in South Africa, in Nigeria, and soon in Canada. The one in Canada will be called O Canada. It's fantastic. In Nigeria, in Tanzania, in Sudan, they've met not only with institutional leaders, but also national leaders as well. And so there's this huge push from students establishing these entire organizations with open access at the heart. Then I want to close my third and final story with David Carroll and Joe MacArthur, who are, a pharmacology student in Joe's case and a medical student in David's, from the UK, who established a project called the Open Access Button. How many of you have heard of the Open Access Button before? Nice, that's awesome. That's very good. So for many of you that haven't, the Open Access Button is a really good idea that I think a lot of people have, but nobody actually ever did. So I met David and Joe at a medical student conference in 2013, started talking to them about open access, and sort of their thought, which came in an email at 1 a.m, because they're students, was, everybody's so familiar with hitting paywalls, but there's no you can't do anything, right? There's not a pop-up that says, like, you've hit a paywall, the system sucks, this is why, like, this is what you can do to change it. And that's what they wanted to create. And so that was this sort of the initial idea behind the open access button, to have sort of a tool so that when people hit paywalls, it would sort of pop up and allow them to register their frustration. And so it's done a really good job of that. It's registered, I think, over 10,000 collisions with paywalls and captured a lot of stories. But I think it's a credit to their thinking and sort of the power of sort of the strategizing of students and early career researchers, that they realized if they wanted for this to be successful, they needed to make it genuinely useful for researchers to actually build into their workflow. And so what they did was try to actually make the button go out and find freely accessible copies of articles. So when people hit paywalls, they can register their frustration, but it also does searches online and looks through repositories to try to find freely accessible copies, which is, you know, fantastic. They've also come out with a new feature that's still sort of in the process of rollout, which I think could actually be really revolutionary, which is an automated system where people are trying to get access to an article and can't. It actually automatically scrapes the email address for the corresponding author and sends them an email saying, somebody's trying to read your work, somebody's trying to build on it. Send us a link to an article where we can make it available, and we will connect that audience with your work. And you know, they're very deeply sort of appreciative of the repository community. It's where they sort of do a lot of the queries for freely accessible copies. And so, you know, they want to build in sort of the repositories into this workflow, so they're pointing people to deposit in their institutional repositories or other repositories for their work. So I think this is a really good example of sort of students moving even beyond advocacy and actually building infrastructure for the open access movement. And again, they're not alone. Some of you are probably familiar with the Open Library of the Humanities project that was recently funded by, it'll come to me. Anyway, but it's actually led by a student, or excuse me, not a student, a fairly early career researcher named Martin Eve. And so just another example of sort of how early career researchers are really building the infrastructure. I just want to close with a plug for a conference that we started last year called OpenCon, which is a conference specifically for sort of the most engaged, interested students and early career academic professionals, so early career researchers, librarians, and so forth. And that are interested in open access, open educational resources, and open data. And the idea behind this meeting is really to try to bring sort of the best folks that are really leading the charge within the next generation together to sort of build a community as well as catalyze new projects. Because we're trying to bring the best folks together, we try to give as much travel funding as we can to students and early career researchers, since they, you know, don't really have really good access to travel funding. And so because of that, it's actually by application only. And in the past 2 years, for last year's meeting and now this year's meeting, we've actually received more than 5,000 applications from over 156 countries of students and early career researchers that want to attend, that are interested or already engaged in these issues. And so this is a map of all the countries where we got applications from this year. So you can see it's a pretty complete map of the world, which is really, really exciting. And so I just want to close by, you know, saying that this is an issue that a large number of students and early career researchers care very, very deeply about. And so I would just sort of challenge you all, if you're not already working with students and early career researchers, to really think of them as central to everything that you're trying to do to advance open access here within the UC system.
So I'm going to cover slightly different material and focusing on a little bit on what we've been doing at UC Press. And as the only publisher up here, I hope that I can sort of demonstrate some of the ways in which I think, you know, publishers do have some value to add going forward, although I think it's very different from what we've been doing in the past. And I think it's clear that there are different kinds of publisher, just as there are different kinds of open access. And so we, as a university presses as a whole, I think, have been painfully slow to respond to the opportunities and challenges of open access. And that's something that we're really trying to change at UC Press right now. So I think, you know, we've brought some of that criticism on ourselves, and certainly not sort of distinguishing ourselves from the behavior of some of our larger competitors, shall I say. So what I'd like to do today is spend a little bit of time talking about the two programs that we launched earlier this year at UC Press, but really to focus more on why we developed the programs in the way we have, how we went about that, some of the issues that we've run into as we've tried to sort of develop that, responses from librarians and faculty and other stakeholders, and just to talk very, early days at this point about some of the results we're seeing there. So I wanted to start by just sort of taking a step back and talking about how we got to the point we did and the programs that we developed. We really, you know, as we started thinking, you know, my first couple of years at UC Press, there was a lot of kind of getting through crisis and reorganizing the press and really getting ourselves ready to sort of enter the digital age, as I think a lot of publishers have needed to do. Having done that, we really wanted to focus on how we were going to build our program and really redefine what the role of a university press was in an increasingly digital and open age. And so for us, open access was a really core part of that. So before we sort of jumped in and just sort of, you know, launched another journal, tried to start a monograph program, we really sort of took a step back to try and think about what the goals were of the open access movement and where we'd got to at that point. So access was clearly a really big issue, and it was interesting hearing Mike talking earlier that access wasn't sort of front and center as they thought about it. But when we thought about access, we thought about the, you know, what was the benefit of open access, and it was really about driving faster innovation cycles and being able to improve research. But there is another part of access, which is about making sure that trusted information is available to anyone who needs it, regardless of ability to pay, and that being front and center. Then I think there was a secondary issue, which was embraced perhaps by the library community early on, even more than researchers, which was about cost and the soaring cost of scholarly journals and the contrast of declining library budgets pitted against what was seen as, quite rightly, the very large profits being made by some of the commercial publishers. And so if we take a step back and think about how have we done on both those fronts, as you've heard from speakers so far today, we've made significant progress in some areas in terms of the number of articles that are available, whether immediately through open access or later through different repositories. There are a lot more open access journals out there, many of them at this point primarily on a gold model. And there is more flexibility in terms of licensing terms from publishers to accommodate those mandates. That said, I think, you know, as we've heard today, we've still got a long way to go. And there was an interesting piece just earlier this week in the Scholarly Kitchen, for those of you who read it, by Joe Esposito, talking about the danger of open access being co-opted by the traditional players. And I think arguably that's something that we're seeing right now. The percentage of open access articles, I think, is not yet dominated by the large players, largely because of PLOS and the number of articles that are published through PLOS. But if you take them out of the equation and you look particularly at the number of open access articles that are being published in hybrid journals owned by commercial publishers, what you see is a real danger of that happening. I'm sure you're all familiar with some of the statistics out there and, you know, Wellcome's data in the UK that showed that over 50% of their APC funding went to Elsevier. I was at a conference earlier this year where the keynote speaker over dinner was the CEO of Springer, who quite openly admitted that APCs had become a very nice source of incremental revenue for them. So if you only care about access, then maybe that's okay, but I think there are many of us here and many people in this room who would like to think that it was about a little bit more than that, and I think that's where the challenge still lies. And I think, you know, and Chris started to talk about this in terms of the issues that were faced rolling out the policy within the UC, but the impact of those OA models has primarily been for journals, and it has primarily been within certain STEM fields. As we know, not all of those are equal, but the impact and the opportunity for open access has really been limited to those fields that have grant funding to cover costs of publication. And then, of course, there's this challenge of faculty and faculty attitudes to open access, and the fact that the majority of faculty, for whatever reason, have not really embraced OA, and there are, of course, many reasons for that. So as we thought about what we wanted to do at UC Press and how to enter this space, we sort of went back to the basics, thinking about, well, we don't have to do what's out there, we don't have to do what we've already done. If we were redesigning this, what would it look like? And so we went back to sort of, you know, talking to, we had interviews with hundreds of faculty within the UC and beyond. We did a lot of survey work, really getting a sense of what was out there. And so, you know, we started with a handful of basic principles. One was really meeting the needs of key stakeholders within the system. And we sort of identified those as authors, what we'd call content producers, readers, the consumers of content, and then librarians, who in the current system at least are the purchasers of content in the majority of cases. And so we wanted to get back to models that were really sort of designed for, by the community, for the community, understanding as well that those communities would be different as we looked at different disciplines. So as a nonprofit organization, we've been in a unique position to create some partially subsidized models that help get some of this off the ground and that help offset the high cost of entry into publishing, particularly for certain fields. So I'm going to talk a little bit first about Calabra, which is our open access journal that launched earlier this year. And in many ways, there are things that you would expect to see in a lot of the open access mega journals that are out there. So it's funded by APCs, but we have been able to keep a very low APC. You'll see here the APC for Calabra is $875. But I think what really sets it apart beyond that is this sort of model of transparency and what we've called value sharing that we've been trying to set up with Calabra. And so it supports all of you know, the kind of open access principles you'd expect from other OA journals in terms of open review, data sharing, those kinds of things. But we really wanted to think about how we could sort of do something different in a number of ways. So the model here is that the revenue is generated by the APCs, but it's the first, I think, OA journal that assigns a sort of what we call, you know, a monetary value to the peer review and editorial work that goes into making the journal. So there is a fee for providing a review. I think it's important to make it clear that the payment is for the activity. So it's there's no incentive to accept papers, whether you accept or reject a paper, there's a payment. And without going into sort of the complex models, there's a way in which over, you know, a period of time, once a quarter, we look at the fund that's there, and there's a payment that's made to both the editors and to reviewers who've participated. But we've taken that one step further. One of the things that we were interested in trying to do with Calabra was to think about disciplines beyond those that can easily fund APCs. And so the pay it forward aspect of Calabra, I think, is the second part that's really unique. So the idea is that once you know, you know, you have $100 or whatever that you've earned in this period, you can decide to cash out and take the money, or you can pay it forward in one of two ways. You can pay it into your institution's open access fund, typically managed by the library, or you can pay it forward into a waiver fund that we've created for Calabra. And what we're hoping to do through that, particularly through the Calabra waiver fund, is to be able to fund disciplines that don't typically have money to fund APCs. So we very deliberately launched in three broad disciplinary areas, life sciences, environmental sciences, and then social and behavioral sciences, where you have very varying levels of funding. And so part of what we're interested in doing is really sort of testing out this model. Now, it's very early days. In the research that we did up front, I think it was well over 50% of authors said that they would pay it forward. Of course, behavior may not follow what they said they would do. And so, you know, it's a little early days for us to actually know what that looks like at this point.
Don't ask an economist to model it for
you. And we've just, I mean, we're sort of very late stages. We've published a couple of papers. But just in the first couple of papers we've published, we've had, I think, I just saw today, over 7,000 downloads. So again, if you think of typical journal subscriptions, that's really great sort of reach in comparison. Then I'm going to talk a little bit more about Luminous, which is our open access monograph publication. And so there's a very different set of issues with books and with the fact that books typically come from disciplines in the humanities and social sciences. And so monographs remain a vitally important form of scholarly communication in many of these fields. And so we were really interested in not only how do we preserve the monograph, but how do we help the monograph sort of move forward into the opportunities of a more digital and open way of publishing. But there are some really unique challenges in moving monographs from the current model into a digital and open access model. The obvious one is funding, and that there is little or no funding in these fields. So the idea of paying anything for publication, let alone as much as $15,000, when you look at, you know, many humanities faculty, even on UC campuses, can't afford to have phones in their offices anymore. So, you know, it's a pretty serious issue. Then there are issues around licensing. And so, you know, the response that you hear from humanities and social science faculty to the idea of CC BY is very problematic. And The way in which a lot of the models have developed have really been with journal articles in mind and different disciplines in mind. So that's been a big stumbling point. There are issues around third-party rights, particularly in fields like art and art history. And I think also the complexity of trying to deal with all of this is heightened by the fact that we are trying to move monographs to open access and digital at the same time. And when you think about journals, digital had become the primary form of publication for journals a decade or so before open access really started to gear up and mandates started to come into place. So, you know, when you talk to faculty in these fields, you find very often there's a real conflation of issues and concerns about journal, about digital and open access coming together. So the model that we've come up with, understanding that there isn't a sort of single stakeholder within the system who can fund all of these costs as it stands today, is a shared model. So UC Press continues to support and subsidize monograph publishing, as it always has. There's a contribution that comes from libraries, and I'll talk about that more specifically in a minute. We are making print on-demand editions available at a reasonable price, sort of $30 to $35 paperbacks, and we expect that to generate some revenue. But then there's a contribution that comes from the author, or as we expect more typically, from the author's institution. Our baseline cost there is $7,500. There's a discount on that for UC faculty. We receive a subsidy that supports UC faculty in their publications. So the starting point for UC faculty would be $5,000. And that goes up depending on length and complexity and some of these other issues. But there are some real benefits to this model. I mean, for example, POD and digital allow us to include integrated color in books, which, you know, you wouldn't be able to do in a traditional monograph these days. So there's some real benefits to authors beyond the reach factor. The library model works a little bit like this, which is, I mean, essentially, I think, you know, at its heart, it's an NPR model. So it's sort of crowdfunding, you know, please give us your money and be a member library and a supporter. And I'm delighted to say we already have a couple of UC libraries who are. So the idea is we've got four different tiers of membership. Libraries can join to help support open access publishing. The funding goes to two different places. We take about $2,000 from this fund to help support each individual title we publish. Anything that is left over from that will go into an author waiver fund to support authors at institutions that really don't have the funds for this. And there are, you know, at this point, with the numbers that we're talking about, there are a good number of those. So in terms of what we've seen to date, we've just published our first six titles. We have used the waiver fund to support two of those authors. The other titles that we all have in production at the moment are about 12 of those. Most of those, the authors have been able to find funding either from their own institution or in a couple of cases, there are authors who've had grants from places like the Ford Foundation that strongly support open access. I think some of the interesting things that we've seen have been sort of the reactions from authors, which have been really mixed at this point. Generally pretty positive, but when you see very clearly the lack of understanding about what digital and open access actually means in this world. So we did a survey and got close to 1,000 results before we moved forward. And we had responses that sort of ran the gamut from incredibly positive to one response that I remember, which is, I will never publish with UC Press again if you proceed with this program. So there are some pretty strong feelings out there, but I think, you know, when you hear those very extreme ones, it's really not understanding what this is about. I mean, essentially what we're talking about is a different way of covering the cost of publication. That's what it is at its heart. What we've heard from authors on the whole has been pretty positive. We've now got to a point where we've launched the program, we've published six books, we've actually started to get authors approaching us and saying they would like to publish in this way. We have at this point very deliberately left it entirely the author's choice as to whether they publish in Luminous or whether they publish a monograph in a traditional way with UC Press. So as our editors, our acquisitions editors are talking with authors, they talk to them about the two different models and it's really left entirely up to the author. I think in these early days of open access monographs, that's really critical. One of the things we have worked very, very hard to avoid in these fields is any sense of this being a second tier option. And, you know, that's still very different in monographs where open access is still in very, very early days. So that's been really important to us. But just, you know, in the first month that we've had our first six titles published, we've already had over 700 views and downloads, so significantly higher than you would see from a typical monograph, even over its lifetime. We haven't got yet the kind of data that Catherine has got in terms of access, but if you look at other pilot programs like Knowledge Unlatched, you see really significant access from parts of the globe, as we've seen with CDL, that typically wouldn't have access to this content. You know, that said, I think there's still a lot of really serious work to be done in open access. You know, I think Mike touched on a lot of the issues that I was going to talk about earlier, about the issues with faculty and winning over academic opinion. And so, you know, at the root of this problem is this sort of entrenched value system that values where you publish. In certain fields, it's journals. In monographs, it's the university press that publishes your book, and the university press brand plays very much the same role as the journals brand. And I think that's really something that there is a bottom-up way of starting to address that, but really to be able to address that, it's going to take some top-down attention as well. And I think the funding challenge is another one. So the model that we've put together for Luminous is, I think, one that really allows us to get started publishing open access monographs. I'm not sure it's one that's really scalable and sustainable over the long term. And so I think if we're really serious about expanding open access, there has to be a sort of way of addressing funding at a more system-wide level. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
So let's spend a few minutes talking as a panel before we open it up to audience questions. And I'll start. So I can't resist turning back to Mike's opening keynote, where, Chris, you missed it, unfortunately, but I'll give away one of your punchlines was, we should publish less. Very provocative. Mike's punchline, I think, was that we should publish everything and do our peer review and evaluation after it's published. That's clearly, Allison, you're pursuing a model that retains the publisher as gatekeeper. You have acquisitions editors, and I think, and you send things out for review and have a model for doing that. So I'm curious to both of you what your reaction is to the idea that we might revolutionize the system by publishing everything as opposed to publishing less. And then I'm curious for Catherine whether CDL has any, I know that you have various platforms that help faculty members who are trying to start new journals and innovate in publishing models, whether any of those are compatible with the idea of publishing more and doing peer review later once things are already out there.
I'll sort of jump in initially. So I think we're trying to do a little bit of each. I mean, there is a way. I mean, one of the goals of Luminous is to enable us to be able to publish more monographs. Monograph output has been limited, certainly at this. The data in the UK is a little different and in the rest of Europe. But in the US, at least, most university presses have had to decrease the number or at least cap the number of monographs they publish. And that's really because of a model that has to be funded by the market, which doesn't really work for this kind of scholarship. So one of the goals of a program like Luminous is to enable us to make decisions about what to publish that are based on the value and quality of the scholarship and not on whether we can sell enough copies to cover the costs. Now, then you do start getting into questions around the value of peer review and some of the issues that Mike was discussing earlier. You know, right now in the system and the authors and the constituency that we're looking to serve, we're not there yet. I do think that there's scope for experiments within peer review and doing things differently. That said, I do think there's also the issue that Catherine raised around some kind of curation and knowing where to go as a trusted source and how people make those evaluations. And certainly academics and researchers are able to make those in a very different way to maybe students and certainly to a wider public.
I'm sort of curious about whether or not publishing less and publishing everything are actually the same goal. And one way that I think about this, and maybe you talked about this, is that this actually goes to the heart of how the article and the book, but let's start with the article, has been defined as a container, right? And so, and that has largely been defined, I think, by the publishing industry and not by academics, right? And it's slowly morphed over time. So everyone in the sciences is familiar with the technique of taking one experiment and getting 10 papers out of it, right? So you know, that is not something that we do because it is the right way to disseminate our research. It's something that we do because we're rewarded for having 10 instead of one. So you could publish everything in one container, right, and still publish less in that context. In books, it's different for historical reasons. I just want to amplify this point that Allison just made, which is that we've already been forced to publish less, and we've been forced to publish less because it's not profitable, right? So open access in the Luminos model is not just a solution to the access problem, it's also a solution to the fact that there's a ton of monographs out there, some of which are extremely high quality, which no one will publish because they can't sell more than 200 copies of them. So, you know, that's the problem we need to solve in the monograph publishing world.
I want to respond to your question about whether we have journals that are approaching peer review differently. No. And I think that it's because, and we have almost 80 journals in eScholarship now. These are journals that are affiliated with UC either because of a faculty member or graduate student or undergrad involved. Some of them are local, especially the undergrad publications, but many of them are international. I think that the problem here is one of validity. And particularly because these are journals that are attempting to find a space in a field that already has certain practices, and so they can't change everything all at once. So they keep peer review intact, and they have an illustrious editorial board, but you can openly access the materials. That just speaks to what we've been talking about so far, you know, which is the problem of finding a space for this kind of research that doesn't replicate the problems that gave rise to it to begin with.
Nick, what about all the brilliant young people that you hang out with? Do they have a solution to this problem?
I think that the problem with getting monographs published is certainly something that early career researchers feel very, very directly. I think, you know, it's really difficult with early career researchers because, I mean, a lot of the ones that we work with, you know, feel stuck. They sort of, their values are open. They want to make all of their work openly accessible, but they also want to have a career in the academy. And not all of them, you know, it's not even about sort of self-confidence. I mean, it's just they really want to have a career, and they sort of see this real attention and feel it every day. So right now we're sort of forced to say, you know, we understand, you know, you have to publish, you know, sometimes in places if you're worried that it's going to affect your career, but at least like make, you know, the copy of the manuscript available through an institutional repository, take other steps while we try to sort of flip the system and sort of join with your peers in trying to sort of shift the system to a more open model so there isn't this choice.
So I think now we have about 15 minutes for questions from the audience, and I bet a microphone will go around to you. Is that right?
Thank you. I wanted to kind of ask whether or not you find it somewhat ironic that we are now developing a different class system. Nick was talking about, you know, publishing the right journals. But now we're starting to talk about being the right place so you can be part of something that you have to pay for, or an OpenCon conference to which you have to apply, you know, which I find somewhat ironic as well. Maybe at the UC system, faculty are in a position to get more resources to participate in these kinds of things, but at many universities, that's not the case. I also think that it's probably true also that when you get into some of the disciplines, some of the disciplines are much more open than others. Some have more money than others. I just see a different class structure developing, and I'm a bit worried about that. Would you care to comment?
Well, I mentioned this only very briefly at the end, but I think one of the things that doing this policy and talking to lots of people across the system made very clear to me was the existence of that kind of class system within the UC system, right? So not even between UC and other systems, but the existence of massive numbers of basically precarious positions, adjunct positions, alt-ac positions, clinical positions, temporary things, which have been expanding dramatically over the last 10, 20 years, right? Now, so the interesting question for us is, what's the role of publication for those people, right? We are going to tell, Mike and I, full professors, are going to tell these people, write a really good paper and maybe you'll get a job, right? Not necessarily publish it in Nature, but write a really good paper, communicate your research, et cetera. That may or may not be true, given the economics of the university at this point. We always say that open access is an advantage for those people because there's more citations, there's more visibility, there's more of the paper, basically, for people who are interested in the research. But I think it actually raises and sort of opens up for us a question about how that class system within the university is also changing right now. And for some of those people, it might not actually be to their benefit to be writing papers, much less paying to make them open access, right? Other kinds of constraints on their success may actually be more important than the production of research. So thinking about that is something I think we haven't really done in the open access movement and probably should.
Just to quickly respond to that, I guess the OpenCon part of that, I totally understand sort of the counterintuitive nature of having a conference on open that requires an application. The reason for that is we want sort of the best folks in the room, not the people that can pay in the room, the best folks. So last year, we convened 115 students and early career researchers from 39 countries. 82% of those were fully supported to attend. The majority of that funding went to students from the Global South. That's why it's application only, because if we filled the room with just people that could pay, then we would have a room full of like North American folks and Europeans, and we want to be inclusive of the entire conversation. And so in order to do that in sort of a space-limited setting, that's why we have this application process, because we feel like it most equitably distributes this sort of chance to engage. That said, the in-person meeting is actually only one small component. We actually have, I think, more than 20 now partners hosting satellite events for OpenCon, I think on every continent now. So there are sort of ways to take this in-person sort of experience and replicate it in other places so that sort of this crunch, having a meeting is never gonna scale, right? So these sort of satellite events are ways to sort of reach people with that in-person experience in ways that you can't, just by paying people to fly to one place.
I have a nuts and bolts question for Catherine, but actually let me just respond to that too for a second, which is to say that it's completely right. The model of paying to publish is not a good one. It's one that was imposed on the, in the open access at the beginning because all of the money that was being used for publishing, which is, in sciences, it's something like $9.5 billion a year, was being channeled to publishers through subscription fees and wasn't accessible in any way to everybody else. But I think it should be clear that the right way to do this is centralized funding of publications so that everybody can participate in a way that's completely independent of their ability to pay. And I think a system like that, if it were implemented, would be infinitely cheaper than what we're doing right now. I mean, I always tell people, if you gave me, instead of $10 billion, if you gave me $1 billion a year and said, publish everything that everybody produces in the universe, I could do it and I would be incredibly wealthy on top of it, because it just doesn't cost nearly, the money is just an inefficiency, it's not systemic. So it's completely right, it's something we have to be really attentive to in the future and make it clear that the vision that we really should have is not of one where everybody pays to publish, but of one where nobody pays to publish or read, and that's the system we need. Okay, so now my nuts and bolts question is, what is stopping CDL from harvesting all of the papers? I mean, there's software people use. I use, commercial, just a little small commercial company called PaperPile as a program that I use to keep track of all my papers, where I just click a button and it, 99% of the time, successfully downloads the PDF. Is it a technological thing that prevents you from doing it? Which I assume it's not. But is it the fact that you're not allowed to harvest it or you're not allowed to distribute it that's the problem once you've done it? And another related question. Yeah. Since we haven't gotten to the Berkeley part of this implementation, are we asking people to give you the PDFs of their published papers or of their manuscripts? And what's the...
Those are two very closely related questions. The reason that we can't just harvest publications is because what we're collecting, ostensibly, is the author's final version.
If we collect the publisher's version, which has all of the markings of the publisher, then we perhaps have the right to do that. It's not clear. And if we do it, we open ourselves up to a lot of attention from the publishers. And so we describe a process in which faculty upload their final version, which is post peer review, but pre-formatting by the publisher. And you can't really, you can't harvest those because they tend to be on hard drives.
No, I sort of figured that was the answer. So is there any thinking that of trying to get UC faculty to change their author agreements to allow for the harvesting of the PDFs, the published PDFs?
Yeah, I mean, our negotiations with publishers could be a good way to go for that. We could also push the envelope and start, is this being recorded?
Just, I'll say it. They could just do it and see.
And they kind of are.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the things we're noticing when we look at the papers that are coming in is that, you know, some of them are authors' final versions, but a lot of them are just
publishers' PDFs. I don't have my final versions of most of my papers anymore.
And so, but if we adopt that as a policy or an implementation of the policy, I think we're on thin ice, or we'd be the first. Yes, but it doesn't make sense. And faculty are unclear about what the author's final version is. I mean, we're often unclear, and from discipline to discipline, it looks different. So it's a real hurdle. If we could negotiate with the publishers, if we could have relationships with the publishers in which perhaps they allow the final version, or perhaps they have the author's final version, if they could share that with us, and we have a DOI, and it goes back to the, I mean, you know, there are a lot of ways we could go here that don't put the burden on the faculty to keep track of that file.
One piece of news that people might have missed because it's just out this morning is that the Google Book Search appeal was decided in Google's favor. And I haven't finished reading it yet, but I bet it might tell us some useful things about when it's within fair use to digitize copyrighted works for not for purposes of making them accessible, but perhaps for archival purposes or at least for search purposes if we had a dark archive of the published version. I mean, that would be useful for us to have as... for you to have as librarians to preserve the work of scholars at UC.
Yeah.
We can arrange that.
Yeah, I'm a history faculty at Berkeley. I know nothing about open access. I'm on the Senate Library Committee, and this is something that I want to know about because it's obviously important, the future. And it's also problematic to me as a humanist, or I think I'm more of the humanities side of the history than the social science side. And I was curious that one of you at least mentioned that humanities faculty and some social science faculty are less eager to join. And I have to admit, I'm one of them. Especially after listening to this. This conference, I don't mean this as a criticism, it's just what you expect. This is kind of like you're preaching to the choir here, and I'm not the choir. I'm not Satan, but I'm a sinner. I fully agree. There's too much published. I've been saying this for 20 years, 25 years. There's way too much published. It's junk. It's done for all the reasons that you pointed out. I don't need to repeat those reasons. But having said that, there are journals that I really like that do a great job for my discipline. There are some journals that I don't like, but I think they still do an important job for the discipline. And what I've been astonished at ever since I started hearing about open access was the problem of copyright. And I'm astonished that that word it's been sort of like, you know, you edge around it, but you don't actually address the issue. And when you do start to address the issue, you say, am I being recorded? So I'd like to hear from the choir what the issue of copyright is and why you think that more humanities faculty seem to share my conclusion. I don't know if they share my reasoning. I'd like to know what you think their reasoning is.
So I'll say a couple things about copyright. I need to leave right after the session to get ready to teach my intellectual property class, where I'll be teaching copyright today, so this will be a good warm-up for that. So I'll just say a couple basic things, and then I think Chris or others can talk about the politics and different interests of people from different fields. So the first thing to know is that we as scholarly authors and all authors, we own the copyrights in the works that we create.
And it's our choice to assign those to publishers or not, or to maintain control of our work, or to assign just some permission to publishers to do the work that they need to do to get our stuff out there in the world. And the open access policy is consistent with that idea that we can choose to retain our copyrights to give CDL some permission to make our work accessible. And
because there's a tacit agreement, a kind of social contract, an equity, okay, between me as the holder of the copyright and the publisher that I in fact choose to publish with, that I give them my, you know, I give them my copyright so that they can publish an article by me, and that's my way of supporting them.
Well, that has certainly been the habit of many academics, but it's not a tacit agreement, it's usually an express agreement. We sign publication agreements that specify very clearly what rights we're assigning and what rights we're not assigning. I think people like Allison are pursuing as publishers models where they don't need necessarily to make their revenues by selling copies of the work, but instead can pursue other models for doing that to stay in existence and perhaps to support the kind of journals that you support without having to take and fully enforce those copyrights.
I think, and even
I'm still the
he's got that look on his face.
You're not in the choir yet.
Yeah, no, he's still not in the choir. I mean, perhaps a more general one is this point that the Authors Alliance starts with, which is the question of whether you're making a choice to publish something that you want people to read, or whether you're making a choice to publish something that you want people to buy, right? And those are not necessarily compatible, right? So the crisis in monograph publishing in history especially, but also in English and classics and all of the allied disciplines that rely on monographs, has been that we can't sell more than 200 copies because we sell them to libraries, right? And so that's a very small number of readers. That's smaller than my son's kindergarten class, right? That's a really, really tiny number of readers. So I think everyone agrees they'd like more readers, right? But if the economics of the situation are you have to sell 200 copies to make it worth me publishing your book, then there's a whole range of people that are cut out, don't even have the choice to transfer their copyright to the publisher, right? So I guess what we're doing here is trying to weigh the benefits of moving to a system where more things are published, more monographs are published, and more readers read them, and an existing system that preserves the press through a model of selling copies of books, right? So when I said that the debate in OA today is about money, I mean it, right? Like, that is where we're at. We are really talking about different business models, like what Allison is doing, like what UC Press is doing, and what, you know, various collectives around the country and the world are doing to try and figure out how to preserve their control over the things they publish, but still use publication as a means of getting things out there in the world, right? So.
I think this is a follow-up to that question, but also for Allison. I just got back from an interesting ARL conference where Michigan and Indiana were reporting on the models they were investigating, where the university would support academic publishing in the social sciences and humanities as a way to support mm-hmm. these disciplines. And as the person from Michigan said, they did the math and they could fund all the monographs that were being produced by humanities and social science scholars at Michigan for less than they are paying for one chemist to have a lab. Yeah. And so when you say, why are the humanities and social sciences not been supportive of it? I think part of it is they felt they hadn't had a dog in this fight. That a lot of the humanities and social science journals have been relatively cheap. It hasn't been what we've been seeing the price gouging with Elsevier and with Springer. And so we have to address that reality. But where they're hurting is in long-form scholarship that we can't get published and we can't get access to. And so my question is UC getting on board with some of the initiatives like Indiana's and Michigan's that are looking at how to provide equitable access to the scholarship that's needed?
Yeah, a great question, and I'm familiar with the Indiana, and they just issued their draft report that I've seen, and they're doing some really interesting work. I mean, I think this comes back to the issue that I raised at the end of my comments, which is, you know, what we have at the moment is a kind of sort of hybrid gold model that allows us to start doing this. Is it going to be a model that's really scalable and sustainable over the long term? I don't think so. But that does require institutions to really start doing their part. There've been, as you may know, there's been a working task force between AAU and ARL over the last couple of years, which has managed to come to absolutely nothing, as far as I can work out. So our sense at UC Press is we just need to start doing this, because there are so many other issues with moving monographs that go beyond the funding. Funding is a big one, but you know, what's the right CC license model for books and so on? There are a whole host of issues that need to be addressed beyond the simple funding question for monographs. But I think you're absolutely right. The central funding makes more sense. I did a presentation to UCLASC, another of those great acronyms, early this year, talking about this program. And one of the questions to me was, well, wouldn't it be a whole lot easier if the UC just paid for this? And my answer is, sure. But I don't hear anybody in the Office of the President offering to increase our subsidy. But there are institutions. So UCLA is a great example. They've been very on board with this. The chair of our editorial committee right now, Todd Presner, is on the faculty at UCLA, and together with Sharon and Ginny in the library have really helped kind of drive this forward there. And so the Dean of Humanities at UCLA has made a commitment that he has the funding for anybody who wants to publish this way. And his point to the institution is, you know, the cost of $5,000 to publish a monograph in Luminous is budget dust in terms of the entire UCLA budget. It's going to take a long time for us to sort of get to that point across different institutions. And I think it comes back to this need for sort of both top-down and bottom-up ways to address the problem. Yes, it needs faculty to start really getting behind this and asking for it and requiring it. There are a couple of campuses that I've spoken to, just a final point, who are starting to think about publication funding as being part of the hiring package for tenure-tracked faculty in the humanities and social sciences. And that, when you look at the kind of startup cost of a new scientist, that seems like a pretty good way of doing it and a very low-cost way of doing it. So,
I want to put a plug in here for the Pay It Forward project, which is a Mellon-funded research project that involves Davis and CDL and others, because part of what you have to sort of determine before you can imagine the model shifting is, what is a fair APC? And we have APCs, and they run the gamut, and what does it really cost to publish an article, to publish a book? And so there's a lot of economic modeling going on there to try to understand what that looks like and to understand what the implications would be for universities to take over that funding rather than paying someone else to do that work.
We mentioned it before, but it's really important to point out that the central absurdity of scholarly publishing today is that not only do we produce all the content, but we actually completely fund it from the university system. And what we can have all these discussions about how to do it, but we really need to focus on the fact that right now we're paying publishers $10 billion a year to lock papers behind paywalls. Mm-hmm. And it's insane. It's too much. We have the capacity to redo it. And yes, there's complicated questions, but we should really be focusing on the fact that we should be setting the terms, both because we're giving all the money and we're giving all the content, and we should figure out how it should function and not let all these weird, you know, historical things determine it. And you know, in AP, in sciences at least, you know, we pay something like $6,500 per article in subscriptions to support these journals. And so when you talk about APCs of a few thousand dollars, it's best to put it in context of what we're currently paying for the articles. It's a fraction. Even the most expensive APCs are a fraction of what we pay per paper in subscriptions.
And we're getting something different in return.
That's right. We're getting access to the whole world, and it's a totally different. It's a totally different return on investment from the universities. And yes, we have to figure out how to do it fairly. And yes, we have to figure out how to sustain all the things that people like in the current system. But the economics of the current system is just insane.
So it's time to continue our conversation over lunch, where I
understand we have poster sessions and much more to learn. So let's thank our panelists and move on to that.